Chapter 25, Part 2 of Ramona. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Ellie. Ramona by Helen Hunt Jackson. Chapter 25, Part 2. Joss, hearing his name called on all sides, reined in Benito and Baber as soon as he could, and looked around in bewilderment to see what had happened. Before he had time to ask any questions, Felipe had overtaken him, and riding straight to Baber's head, had flung himself from his own horse and taken Baber by the rein, crying, "Baber, Baber!" Baber knew his voice and began to whinny and plunge. Felipe was nearly unmanned. For a second he forgot everything. A crowd was gathering around them. It had never been quite clear to the San Bernardino mind that Joss's title to Benito and Baber would bear looking into, and it was no surprise, therefore, to some of the onlookers to hear Felipe cry in a loud voice, looking suspiciously at Joss, "How did you get them?" Joss was awake, and Joss was never hurried. The man did not live, nor could the occasion arrive which would quicken his constitutional drawl. Before even beginning his answer, he crossed one leg over the other and took a long, observant look at Felipe. Then, in a pleasant voice, he said, "Well, senor, I allow you are a senor by your color. It would take right smart of your time to tell you how I come by that horse and by the other of the two. They ain't mine, neither of em." Joss's speech was unintelligible to Felipe, as it had been to Ramona. Joss saw it and chuckled. "Maybe it would help you to understand me if I was to talk Mexican," and proceeded to repeat in tolerably good Spanish the sum and substance of what he had just said, adding, "They belong to an Indian over on San Jacinto, at least the off one does, and the nigh one's his wife's. He would never call that one anything but hers. It had been hers ever since she was a girl, they said. I never saw people think so much of horses as they did." Before Joss had finished speaking, Felipe had bounded into the wagon, throwing his horse's reins to a boy in the crowd, crying, "Follow along with my horse, will you? I must speak to this man." "Found, found! The saints be praised, at last! How could he tell this man fast enough? How should he thank him enough?" Laying his hand on Joss's knee, he cried, "I can't explain to you. I can't tell you. Bless you forever, forever. It must be the saints led you here." "O Lord," thought Joss, "another of them saint fellas." "I allow not, senor," he said, relapsing into Tennessean. "It was Tom Wormsey led me. I was going to move his truck for him this afternoon." "Take me home with you to your house," said Felipe, still trembling with excitement. "We cannot talk here in the street. I want to hear all you can tell me about them. I have been searching for them all over California." Joss's face lighted up. This meant good fortune for that gentle, sweet Ramona, he was sure. "I'll take you straight there," he said, "but first I must stop at Tom's. He will be waiting for me." The crowd dispersed, disappointed, cheated out of the anticipated scene of an arrest for horse stealing. "Good for you, Tennessee," and "Fork over the black horse, Joss," echoed from the departing groups. Sensations were not so common in San Bernardino that they could afford to slide so notable an occasion as this. As Joss turned the corner into the street where he lived, he saw his mother coming at a rapid run towards them, her sunbonnet half off her head, her spectacles pushed up in her hair. "Why, there's Mummy!" he exclaimed. "Whatever has gone wrong now?" Before he finished speaking, she saw the black horses, and snatching her bonnet from her head, waved it wildly, crying, "Joss, here! Stop! I was here coming to haunt ye!" Breathlessly, she continued talking, her words half lost in the sound of the wheels. Apparently, she did not see the stranger sitting by Joss's side. "Joss, the terriblest news come. That Indian Alessandro's got killed, murdered. Yes, murdered, I say. Tain't no less. There was an Injun come down from the mountain with a letter to the agent." "Good God, Alessandro killed!" burst from Felipe's lips in a heart-rending voice. Joss looked bewilderingly from his mother to Felipe. The complication was almost beyond him. "O Lord," he gasped, turning to Felipe. "That's Mammy," he said. "She was real fond of both of em." Turning to his mother, "This here's her brother," he said. "He just knowed me by Baber. Here on the street, he's been hunting for him everywhere." Aunt Tree grasped the situation instantly. Wiping her streaming eyes, she sobbed out, "Well, I'll allow. Arter this, there is such a thing as a providence, as they call it. Pears like there couldn't anything less brung you here just now. I know who you be her brother Felipe, ain't ye? When is there time she told me about ye? Oh Lord, how are we going to get you to her? I allow she is dead. I allow she'd never live after seeing him shot down dead. He told me ta couldn't nobody get up ta where they had gone. No white folks, I mean. Oh Lord, Lord. Felipe stood paralyzed, horror-stricken. He turned in despair to Jos. Tell me in Spanish, he said. I cannot understand. As Jos gradually drew out the whole story from his mother's excited and incoherent speech and translated it, Felipe groaned aloud. Too late, too late. He too felt as Aunt Ree had, that Ramona never could have survived the shock of seeing her husband murdered. Too late, too late, he cried, as he staggered into the house. She has surely died of the sight. I allow she didn't die neither, said Jos, not so long as she had that young one to look after. You are right, Jos, said Aunt Ree. I'll allow you're right. There couldn't nothing kill her, short of wild beasts, if she had the baby in her arms. She ain't dead, not if the baby's alive, I allow. That's some comfort. Felipe sat with his face buried in his hands. Suddenly looking up, he said, how far is it? 30 miles and more into the valley, where we was, said Jos, and the Lord knows how far this up to the mountain, where they was living. It's like going up the wall, you've a house, going up San Jacinto Mountain, Daddy says. He was there hunting all summer with Alessandro. How strange, how incredible it seemed, to hear Alessandro's name thus familiarly spoken, spoken by persons who had known him so recently, and who were grieving, grieving as friends, to hear of his terrible death. Felipe felt as if he were in a trance. Rousing himself, he said, we must go. We must start at once. You will let me have the horses? Well, I allow you got more right to them than, began Jos energetically, forgetting himself, then dropping Tennessee, he completed in Spanish his cordial assurances that the horses were at Felipe's command. Jos, he's got to take me, cried Ree. I allow I ain't never going to sit still here, and that girl into such trouble. And if so be she's really dead, there's the baby. He hadn't other to go alone by hisself. Felipe was thankful indeed for Aunt Ree's companionship, and expressed himself in phrases so warm that she was embarrassed. Tell him, Jos, she said. I can't never get used to being called Signori. You tell him his sisters always called me Aunt Ree, and I just wish he would. I allow me and him will get along right, pears like I'd known him all my days, just as I did with her after the first. I'm free to confess I take more to these Mexicans than I do to these low-down driven Yankees anyhow. A heap more, but I can't stand being called Signora. You tell him, Jos. I suppose there's a word for aunt in Mexican, ain't there? Pears like there couldn't be no language without such a word. He'll know what it means. I'd go off with him a heap easier if he'd just call me just plain Aunt Ree, as I'm used to, or Miss Hyer. Either one of them, but Aunt Ree is the natural rest. Jos had some anxiety about his mother's memory of the way to San Jacinto. She laughed. Don't you be a mite uneasy, she said. I bet you I'd go clean back to the States the way you came. I allow I've got every mile of it in my head plain's a turnpike. You are not yet dead, neither one of you. Couldn't begin to do it. But what are we going to do for getting up the mountain? That's another thing. That's more than I do know. But there'll be a way provided, Jos. Sure you're born. The Lord ain't going to get hisself hindered helping Ramona this time. I ain't a mite afraid. Felipe could have found no better ally. The comparative silence enforced between them by reason of lack of a common vehicle for the thoughts was on the whole less a disadvantage than would have at first appeared. They understood each other well enough for practical purposes. And the unity in aim and in affection for Ramona made a bond so strong it could not have been enhanced by words. It was past sundown when they left San Bernardino, but the full moon made the night as good as a day for their journey. When it first shone out, Aunt Ree pointed to it and said curtly, "That's lucky." "Yes," replied Felipe, who did not know either of the words she had spoken. "It is good. It shows us the way." "There now, say he can't understand English," thought Aunt Ree. Baba and Benito travelled as if they knew the errand on which they were hurrying. 40 miles they had gone without flagging once, when Aunt Ree, pointing to a house on the right hand of the road, the only one they had seen for many miles, said, "We have to sleep there. I don't know the road beyond this. I allow they are gone to bed, but they'll have to get up and take us in. They're used to doing it. they do considerable business keeping movers, I know 'em. They are real friendly for the kind of people they are. They are rough to death. It can't be far from their time to get up, anyhow. They are up every morning of their lives long afore daylight, a-feeding their stock and getting ready for the day's work. I used to hear 'em and see 'em when we was camping here. I first saw of it, I thought somebody was sick in the house to get them up at that time of night, but afterwards we found out it was nothing but the regular way. When I told Dad, says I, Dad, did you ever hear such a thing as getting up before light to feed stock, and to feed themselves too? Dad, their own breakfast all cleared away, and dishes washed too, before light, and prayers said beside. They are Methodists, terrible pious. I used to tell Dad they talked a heap about believing in God. I don't allow but what that you believe in God, but they don't worship him so much as they worship work, not nigh so much. Believing and worshipping's two things. You wouldn't see no such doings in Tennessee. I allow the Lord meant some of the time for sleeping, and I am satisfied with his times of lighting up. But these Merrills are real nice folks, for all this I've been telling ye. Lord, I don't believe he's understood a word I've said now, thought Aunt Ree to herself, suddenly becoming aware of the hopeless bewilderment in Philippa's face. Tain't much use saying anything more plain yes or no, between folks that can't understand each other's language. And as far as that goes, I allowed her aunt any great use in the biggest part of what's said between folks that does. When the Merrill family learned Philippa's purpose of going up the mountain to the Cahilla family, they attempted to dissuade him from taking his own horses. He would kill them both. High-spirited horses like those, they said, if he took them over that road. It was a cruel road. They pointed out to him the line where it wound, doubling and tacking on the sides of precipices, like a path for a goat. Aunt Ree shuddered at the sight, but said nothing. "I am going where he goes," she said grimly to herself. "I ain't going to back down now, and I do just wish Jeff Ewer was along." Philippa himself disliked what he saw and heard of the grade. The road had been built for bringing down lumber, and for 6 miles it was at perilous angles. After this it wound along on ridges and in ravines till it reached the heart of a great pine forest where stood the sawmill. Passing this, it plunged into still darker, denser woods, some 50 miles farther on, and then came out among vast opens, meadows, and grassy foothills, still on majestic mountains' northern or eastern slopes. From these another steep road, little more than a trail, led south, and up to the Cahilla village, a day and a half's journey at the shortest. It was from Merrill's, and no one unfamiliar with the country could find the last part of the way without a guide. Finally, it was arranged that one of the younger Merrills should go in this capacity, and should also take two of his strongest horses, accustomed to the road. By the help of these, the terrible ascent was made without difficulty, though Baby at first snorted and plunged and resented the humiliation of being harnessed with his head at another horse's tail. Except for the sad errand, both Philippa and Aunt Ree would have experienced a keen delight at this ascent. With each fresh lift on the precipitous terraces, the view of to the south and west broadened, until the whole San Jacinto Valley lay unrolled at their feet. The pines were grand. Standing, they seemed shapely columns. Fallen, the upper curve of their huge yellow discs came above a man's head, so massive was their size. On many of them the bark had been riddled from root to top, as by myriads of bullet holes. In each hole had been cunningly stored away an acorn, the woodpecker's granaries. "Look at it now," exclaimed the observant Aunt Ree. "And there's folks that say dumb critters ain't got brains. They ain't dumb to each other, I noticed. And we are dumb ourselves when we are catched with foreigners. I allow I'm next door to dumb myself with this here Mexican I am travelling with." "That's so," replied Sam Merrill. "When we first got here, I saw that gone clean out of my head trying to make these Mexicans sense my meaning. My tongue was of little use to me. But now I can talk their lingo first rate. But pa, he won't talk to him anyhow. He ain't learned the first word, and he's been here going on 2 years longer than we have." The miles seemed leagues to Philippa. Aunt Ree's drawling tones as she chatted with young Merrill caved at him. How could she chatter? But when he thought this, it would chance that in a few moments more he would see her clandestinely wiping away tears, and his heart would warm to her again. They slept at the miserable cabin in one of the clearings, and at early dawn pushed on, and reached the Cahilla village before noon. As their carriage came in sight, a great running to and fro of people was to be seen. Such an event as the arrival of a comfortable carriage drawn by four horses had never before taken place in the village. The agitation into which the people had been thrown by the murder of Alessandro had by no means subsided. They were all on alert, suspicious of each new occurrence. The news had only just reached the village that Ferre had been set at liberty, and would not be punished for his crime, and the flames of indignation and desire for vengeance, which the aged captain had so much difficulty in allaying on the outset, were bursting forth again this morning. It was therefore a crowd of hostile and lowering faces, which gathered around the carriage as it stopped in front of the captain's house. Entree's face was a ludicrous study of mingled terror, defiance, and contempt. "Of all the low-down, no-count, beggarly trash I ever laid eyes on," she said in a low tone to Merrill, "I allow these here are the worst. But I allowed it flatten us all out in just about a minute, if there was to set about to. If she ain't here, we are in a scrape, I allow." "Oh, they are friendly enough," laughed Merrill. "They are all stirred up now, about the killing of that Indian. That's what makes him look so fierce. I don't wonder. 'Twas a darned mean thing Jim Ferre did. Firing into the man after he was dead. I don't blame him for killing the cuss, not a bit. I'd have shot any man living that had taken a good horse of mine up that trail. That's the only law we stockmen have got in this country. We've got to protect ourselves. But it was a mean, low-lived trick to blow this fellow's face to pieces after he was dead. But Jim's a rough feller, and I expect he was so mad when he see his horse that he didn't know what he did." Entree was half paralyzed with astonishment at this speech. Philippe had leapt out of the carriage, and after a few words with the old captain, had hurried with him into his house. Philippe had evidently forgotten that she was still in the carriage. His going into the house looked as if Ramona was there. Entree, in all her indignation and astonishment, was conscious of this train of thought running through her mind. But never even the near prospect of seeing Ramona could bridle her tongue now, or make her defer replying to the extraordinary statements she had just heard. The words seemed to choke her as she began. "Young man," she said, "I don't know much about your raising. I heard your folks was great on religion. Now we ain't, Jeff and me. We weren't raised that way. But I allow, if I was, to hear my boy Joss, he's just about your age and make too, though he's nearer chested. If I should hear him say what you have just said, I allow I shall expect him to see him struck by lightning, and I shan't think he got more than he deserves. I allow I shouldn't." What more Entree would have said to the astounded Merrill was never known, for at that instant the old captain, returning to the door, beckoned to her, and springing from her seat to the ground, sternly rejecting Sam's offered hand, she hastily entered the house. As she crossed the threshold, Philippe turned an anguished face toward her, and said, "Come, speak to her." He was on his knees by a wretched pallet on the floor. Was that Ramona? The prostrate form, hair disheveled, eyes glittering, cheeks scarlet, hands playing meaninglessly like the hands of one crazed, with a rosary of gold beads. Yes, it was Ramona, and it was like this she had lain there now 10 days, and the people had exhausted all their simple skill for her in vain. Entree burst into tears. "Oh Lord," she said, "if I had some old man here, I'd bring her out of that fever. I do believe I see some on the growing not more than a mile back." And without a second look or another word she ran out of the door, and springing into the carriage said, speaking faster than she had been heard to speak for 30 years, "You just turn round and drive him back a piece, the way we come. I allow I'll get a weed that will break that fever. Faster, faster, run your horses. 'Tain't above a mile back where I seed it," she cried, leaning out, eagerly scrutinizing every inch of the barren ground. "Stop! Here it is," she cried. "I knowed I smelt the bitter and some was here along." And in a few minutes more she had a mass of the soft, shiny, grey, feathery leaves in her hands, and was urging the horses fiercely on the way back. "This will cure her, if anything will," she said, as she entered the room again. But her heart sank as she saw Ramona's eyes roving restlessly over Felipe's face. No sign of recognition in them. "She is bad," she said, her lips trembling. "But never say die is always our motto. Ain't never too late for anything but once, and you can't tell when that time's come till it's past and gone." Streaming bowls of bitterly odorous infusion she held at Ramona's nostrils. With infinite patience she forced drop after drop of it between the unconscious lips. She bathed the hands, the head, her own hands blistered by the heat. It was a fight with death, but love and life won. before night Ramona was asleep. Philippe and Aunt Tree sat by her, strange but not uncongenial watchers, each taking heart from the other's devotion. All night long Ramona slept. As Philippe watched her, he remembered his own fever, and how she had knelt by his bed and prayed there. He glanced around the room. In a niche in the mud wall was a cheap print of the Madonna, one candle just smoldering out before it. The village people had drawn heavily on their poverty-stricken stores, keeping candles burning for Alessandro and Ramona during the past 10 days. The rosary had slipped from Ramona's hold. Taking cautiously in his hand, Philippe went to the Madonna's picture, and falling on his knees, began to pray as simply as if he were alone. The Indians standing on the doorway also fell to their knees, and a low whispered murmur was heard. For a moment Aunt Tree looked at the kneeling figures with contempt. "Oh Lord," she thought, "the poor heathen, praying to a picture. I allow I ain't going to be the only one out here of all the number that don't seem to have nothing to pray to. I allow I'll join in prayer too, but I shan't see mine to the picture." And Aunt Tree fell on her knees, and when a young Indian woman by her side slipped the rosary into her hand, Aunt Tree didn't repulse it, but hid it in the folds of her gown till the prayers were done. It was a moment and a lesson Aunt Tree never forgot. End of chapter 25, part 2, recording by Ellie, September 2009.